Hello friends, this is Rajiv Gupta. I am taking the lectures on High Performance Liquid Chromatography HPLC technique. This is a liquid chromatographic technique. In a previous lecture, we have seen the apparatus or instrumentation of this HPLC instrument. Now we are considering all the parts, the main parts of this HPLC instrument one by one. So the first part is solvent delivery system. In this solvent delivery system, we are considering two topics, solvent reservoirs and degassers and pumps. So this system combinedly provides as a solvent delivery system which delivers solvent or mobile phase inside the HPLC instrument. In a previous lecture, we have seen about solvent reservoirs and degassers. So solvent reservoirs are that glass containers or other type of containers which contains mobile phases. These mobile phases which used to carry sample components in liquid state inside the column. So these things we have seen in an earlier lecture. Now the topic is pumps. These are pressure pumps which pressurized mobile phase to flow through the column, through the packed column of HPLC. So what are the requirements for liquid chromatographic pumps in HPLC? So these are the requirements for the pumps which are designed in factories. So in HPLC pumps, these type of properties should present to occur proper separation and identification. So the first one is the generation of pressures of up to 6000 psi or 414 bar or around 400 atmosphere. Means these HPLC pumps should generate around 6000 pounds per square inch pressure or 414 bar pressure. So this very high pressure these pumps should create. So because at these high pressure, the mobile phase flows through the packed column of HPLC. Because we know that in HPLC, this is also known as high pressure liquid chromatography. So very high pressure should be applied on the mobile phase to flow through the column. So this is the very first requirement of this HPLC pumps. Now the second point is these pumps should be pulse free, or it should provide pulse free output of pressure, because we know that when these pumps work, then the pressure which is generated by these pumps fluctuate with time very frequently. So it is called a pulsating pressure, means pressure somewhat increases and decreases with time very fastly or very frequently inside the plumbing system. So the pumps which are designed or chosen for HPLC should be pulse free. So the pumps are designed like that these should be pulse free. So a pulse damper could be attached with these pumps to reduce or eliminate these type of pulses which are applied on our mobile phase, because these pulses may create any interference or may create any problem during separation in column and also during the detection process. Now the third point is flow rates ranging from 0.1 to 10 ml per minute. The used pumps in HPLC should provide a flow rate in this range. 0.1 ml per minute to 10 ml per minute. So this is the lower value of flow rate and this is the highest value of flow rate. So in between we can set these pumps speed to control the flow rates. So the pumps should be that type, they provide flow rates in between this range. If the range is lower, 0.1 ml per minute means the pump is working slowly at lower pressure, and if the flow rate is higher inside the column, then the pump is working at speed, very high speed and with high pressure. So this thing is also related to pressure which is provided by the pump, because in HPLC column, which is completely packed column with a very small pore size, to flow the sample components with mobile phase, very high pressure is required, and at that high pressure we get this type of flow rates for this liquid chromatography. Generally in liquid chromatography the flow rates are very slower in normal liquid chromatography, but in HPLC we need high flow rates for fast and better separation. Now the fourth point is flow reproducibilities of 0.5% relative or better. These are the flow reproducibilities, means flow rate should not change with a specific pressure greater than 0.5%. Means the error should not be higher than 0.5% in flow rates for a particular pump. Means that pump should provide a constant flow rates or constant pressures during operation, and these should show reproducible nature. So when we use these pumps as daily basis, so these provide same pressure or same flow rates. Now the fifth point is resistance to corrosion by a variety of solvents, because we know that various type of solvents could be used in HPLC depending on the nature of sample. The solvents could be polar, non-polar, semi-polar types. These could be inorganic solvents or organic solvents. So various types of solvents comes into contact with these pumps. So these pumps material or these pumps quality should be like that. These pumps should not corrode in contact with these solvents. Means the pump should be completely inert, should not show any type of reaction with these solvents, because solvents flow continuously for the long time in these pumps. So these pump material could be damaged or corrode in contact with these solvents. So it should be completely resistant or inert for various types of solvents. Now the high pressures generated by liquid chromatographic pumps, as we discussed earlier, this pressure could be 414 bar, that is very high pressure. So at that high pressure, the instrument should not be an explosion hazard. Means in instrument, this HPLC instrument, there should not be a explosion hazard created, because if this explosion happens due to at that high pressure, then these liquids or mobile phases could be spill inside the instrument or in our laboratory, which may create fire or which may create environmental problems. So these pumps and all the plumbing system of HPLC instrument is designed like that it should not create any explosion by applying this high amount of pressure, because we know that the liquids or solvents which are used in HPLC, or generally the liquids, are not compressible or few compressible. So at these high pressures, there could be a leakage happens in this plumbing system. So the whole instrument is designed like that, and pumps also, that there should no leakage or no explosion should happen. Now the types of various pumps are shown here. The major two types of pumps used in HPLC we will study. Actually the three types are present, but one type is old type, which is now currently not used in modern HPLC instruments. But these two types of pumps are highly used in modern HPLC instruments. Specifically, reciprocating pump is highly used. So the first type of pump is the screw-driven syringe type pump, and the second type is reciprocating pump. And it is mentioned here that reciprocating pumps are highly used in modern commercial chromatographs or HPLC instruments. Now first we learn about reciprocating pumps. These reciprocating pumps usually consist of a small chamber in which the solvent is pumped. We can also call this small chamber a type of cylinder, in which a piston is attached, which is motor driven piston, and due to the movement, back and forth movement or motion of this piston inside this chamber or cylinder, the solvent will be pumped from the solvent reservoir to the column or to the sample injection port. So this is a reciprocating pump which works on the basis of cylinder and piston type assembly. So here the forth and back motion of this piston, the solvent or mobile phase moves towards the column. Two ball check valves which open and close alternately control the flow of solvent into and out of the cylinder. So this cylinder, which alternatively filled and empty, filled and empty, is controlled by these two ball check valves, which open and close alternatively. When one ball check valve opens and second is closed, then this cylinder will be filled with mobile phase, and when the first valve is closed and the second is open, then it empty or it will remove the mobile phase from the cylinder. So due to this piston movement, these two ball check valves controls the flow of this mobile phase or solvents inside the cylinder. The solvent is in direct contact with the piston. See here, the solvents are directly contact with the piston of this pump. So the piston and the whole internal assembly should be completely inert towards that solvent, means no type of corrosion should happen. As an alternative, pressure may be transmitted to the solvent via flexible diaphragm, which in turn is hydraulically pumped by a reciprocating piston. So another type of assembly could also be applied or could be designed, where we can use or apply flexible diaphragm inside the cylinder, and this reciprocating piston should not come or may not come in direct contact with the solvent. So this reciprocating pump, by the movement of this back and forth motion, it push and pull this flexible diaphragm inside the cylinder, and increases or reduces the volume of the cylinder. So here a flexible diaphragm could also be used, which may be made up of a very inert material which cannot degrade or corrode with time with the application of these solvents. So this type of assembly could also be applied in these reciprocating pumps. So what is the actual mechanism or working of this reciprocating pump is shown in this second paragraph. On the intake stroke, see, on the intake stroke means when the solvent moves from mobile phase reservoir to the cylinder of reciprocating pump, the piston is withdrawn from the pump head, means it will come out from the cylinder, creating a low pressure zone inside the cylinder. Now at this low pressure, the inlet check valve, which is coming from the mobile phase reservoir, will be opened, but the outlet check valve, which is nearer to the column, will be closed. So due to this, the solvent will move from mobile phase to the cylinder, and here in this process the cylinder will be filled, completely filled with that solvent. Now in the second step, on the delivery stroke, or when the piston moves inside the cylinder and reduces the volume of the cylinder, the solvent chamber, that increases the pressure. In this reverse stroke or delivery stroke, it increases the pressure inside the cylinder. Due to this, the inlet check valve, which is very close to mobile phase reservoir, will be closed, but the outlet check valve, means which is close to column, will be opened. Now this whole filled cylinder, or whole the solvent which is present in cylinder, will be pushed towards the column. Okay, so this is the simple working process of this reciprocating pump, where the piston shows back and forth motion, and due to this motion the pressure inside the cylinder increases and decreases alternatively. When it is decreases, then the cylinder will be filled with the mobile phase from the mobile phase reservoir, and when the in the reverse stroke, the mobile phase, the pressure in the cylinder increases and mobile phase will be pushed towards the column. Now these are the advantages of reciprocating pumps. The advantage of reciprocating pumps include their small internal volume. So this is the internal volume range is shown for the cylinder of the reciprocating pump. It is the range of 35 microliter to 400 microliter. So see, this volume is very small volume. Okay, their high output pressures, in this very small volume, very high pressures could be applied up to 10,000 pounds per square inch. So their adaptability to gradient elution. Okay, these are the advantage. Very low volume, on this low volume solvent, we can apply a very high pressure using the piston. And this type of arrangement we can use for gradient elution chromatography, because during experiment we can change the solvent composition. Their large solvent capacities, means this type of pump can push a very large solvent amount, because it works continuously and takes solvent from mobile phase reservoir and throws to the column, then take from mobile phase reservoir, then throws to the column. So this process can be run until the mobile phase reservoir is empty. So mobile phase reservoir contains very high amount of sample. So we can say that these pumps can carry or show large solvent capacities and their constant flow rates. These reciprocating pumps also show constant flow rates inside the column. These are largely independent of the column back pressure and solvent viscosity. If our solvent viscosity is changed during this experiment or gradient elution, or if there is a back pressure is applied due to that packed column, that this pump does not affected by these two properties, means solvent viscosity and this back pressure which is applied from that packed column. So this is a very very good pump which is used in the current modern HPLC instruments. Now what are the disadvantage of this reciprocating pump? The reciprocating pumps have the disadvantage of producing a pulsed flow. See, this is a very and vast disadvantage of this reciprocating pump, because we have seen that during its operation the pressure inside the cylinder decreases, then it increases, decreases, then it increases alternatively. So due to this increase and decrease of the pressure inside the column, the created pressure is a fluctuating pressure which is called a pulsed pressure. So due to this pulsed pressure we get a pulsed flow, means the flow rate somewhat increase and decrease with time very frequently. So due to that we may get somewhat interfering results in this instrument. So a damping process is required. So we use a pulse damper with this pump. That pulse damper reduces or eliminate this pulsating flow or pulsating pressure which is applied by this column. Okay, so here it is must that pulse damper is highly required. So again we can learn this line: reciprocating pumps have the disadvantage of producing a pulse flow which must be damped because the pulses appear as baseline noise on the chromatogram. So this is the actual non-required output. Due to this pulse flow we get noise in our chromatogram. Finally we get that chromatogram which contains a noise, means unwanted peaks, unwanted small peaks we can see in our chromatogram due to this pulsating flow. So to reduce this we have to use pulse dampers. In modern HPLC instruments, use dual pump heads or elliptical cams to minimize such pulsations. So dual pump heads or elliptical cams instead of round or circular cams, generally elliptical cams, elliptical shape cams are used, which are attached to this piston and electrical motor. So these elliptical cams could minimize such pulsations. So here in a diagram we can show these are the motor and here it is a cam. The cam shape is shown as a elliptical. It is not a round shape or circular, it is a oval shape or elliptical shape. So due to this we can reduce this pulsating flow rates. Or also a device that is pulse damper could be used. So whatever is said in the theoretical part we can understand by seeing the schematic diagram or block diagram of reciprocating pump. Here a electrical motor, we can see this electrical motor is attached to this cam and this cam is attached to this piston. This piston, when this cam rotates with a specific rate which is controlled by this motor, the piston will move back and forth in this direction, then reverse, then is this direction, then reverse, back and forth direction in this cylinder. So it provides a specific fast or slow movement by applying this motor. So this is a piston is shown. This is the complete cylinder part of this pump, and here the whole assembly is set like that or completely sealed, that there could not be a leakage or any other thing should not happen in this pump. Also, the piston is so perfect and fine that this solvent or mobile phase should not flow from this side to this side. Okay, when the piston moves in back direction, means away from this cylinder, then the pressure inside this cylinder reduces. Okay, this is the cylinder, this pressure reduces. So what we see here, the solvent reservoir are present. From these solvent reservoirs, the solvent is coming to this side. So it is the inlet of this pumping system, and this is the outlet of this pumping system. From this outlet, the solvent is moving towards the column. So when the pressure reduced, then what happens? This ball check valve closes this part, or this lumen, or this tube of this pumping system. But this check valve goes far from this lumen and set over this side, and the solvent comes from this side to this side and fill this cylinder, because here the pressure is low, but in this piping system the solvent pressure is comparatively high. So during this process, the whole cylinder will be filled with this mobile phase. Now in the fourth stroke or reverse stroke, that means we can say second stroke, when this piston moves from this side to this side, means two cylinder side, then the pressure over this filled mobile phase increases. Then due to this increment, this ball check valve closes this lumen, this piping system, and this goes to this side, and this lumen remains open in this second stroke. So this solvent will move from this side to column, from inlet outlet to column. Due to generation of this pulse, increment or decrement of pressure inside the cylinder, it will be compensated, or it will be reduced from using this pulse damper. So pulse damper are a specific type of assemblies. This could be a flexible polymers or other things which could reduce the pulsations which are applied on this mobile phase. So this is the simple process of this reciprocating pump. Also, we can show this type of diagram where the cam movement is operated by an electrical motor. This is a piston which can go back and forth, forward and reverse direction, and this movement is very fast. Generally, this movement will be very fast. This filling and emptying alternative process will be very fast. Okay, so first this cylinder filled with the mobile phase, and this check valve will be open and this will be closed in this operation. And in the reverse stroke, when the piston goes away from the cylinder or outside, then this valve will be closed, but this valve will be open. So this type of operation we can see, and here the volume is shown, that is 35 to 400 microliters. So it is very small volume. The cylinder volume is very small. Okay, so this is the simple arrangement of reciprocating pump. So we can draw any type of schematic diagram. This schematic diagram is very good for understanding purpose, where we can see the movement of these ball check valves. Now the second pump is displacement pump and syringe pump. Means its another name is syringe pump. These are the syringe type pumps, the syringe which we use, which we see where we fill a syringe completely and push using a assembly, and the whole solution goes from the needle outside. So on that principle, hold the filled solvent in the syringe will be displaced to the column. So on that principle this syringe pump works. So it is somewhat different from the reciprocating pump. Here we can observe that the pressure applied for this by the syringe pump will be constant, okay. But in case of reciprocating pump, the applied pressure was not same, it was fluctuating, it was pulsating. But in case of displacement pumps, the applied pressures by the pump will be constant. So it is an advantage of the syringe type pump. So what is the description? The displacement pumps usually consist of large syringe like chambers. So these contains large chambers. The chambers will be larger in volume compared to reciprocating pump. In reciprocating pumps, the volume of the cylinder was almost 35 to 400 microliter. But in case of these displacement pumps, we can say that cylinder or the syringe volume will be could be around 250 ml. So the amount of the storing amount of this syringe type pumps are very very higher than reciprocating pumps. Syringe like chambers equipped with a plunger activated by a screw driven mechanism powered by a stepping motor. So here also electrical or stepping motor is used, and this motor will be attached to a screw, a type of screw, and that screw actually work as a piston. We can say a piston inside this syringe, and this moves inside this cylinder of syringe, and in a single stroke it delivers whole the solvent through the to the column. So this is the simple process of this displacement of or syringe type pump. Here rotatory motion provides continuous movement of the mobile phase, rotatory motion of that stepping motor. So here the stepping motor will be controlled with a fixed RPM, and this fixed RPM will provide continuous movement of the mobile phase from the syringe to the column. So this will be, if it is propelled by the revolving screw at greater speed and pushes solvent through the small needle like outlet. These are the most suitable for small bore columns. Small bore columns means the columns which contain a lower lumen diameter, means which contains a lower or shorter inner diameter, that are small bore columns. So a detailed description I will explain in next lecture. So thank you for listening this lecture.